Hey guys, welcome to Book Review 160. Today I am going to be reviewing River at the Center of the World, A Journey Up the Yangtze and Back in Chinese Time by Simon Winchester. There you go. So Simon's idea was that he'd go up the Yangtze from its mouth to its source, and in the process kind of cover some of the history of the Yangtze and of China in general. Now I will say, my first criticism, I guess we'll start with a criticism, is Simon is from England and the book is very Anglo-centric. Not to say that the English didn't play a major role in kind of the 18th and 19th centuries and even kind of into the 20th century along the river, but it just feels kind of disproportionate to the Chinese, who were, it's obviously their native land and what they did. So he first starts, as I said, at the mouth and kind of talks about some of the early history of dredging the mouth of the Yangtze. This is essentially what opened it up to ship traffic from abroad. Previously, the Yangtze was used as kind of a inner transportation route, but there was really not a lot of sea traffic, primarily because China was sort of insular. Let's see, what else did he say in that section? He just talked about kind of the grizzled boat drivers that were a part of this group that went, and kind of the how the shoals along the delta formed, that being sort of like mud that and silt that stacks up for a time along the Yangtze. Second, he went to the city with no past. This is Shanghai. Shanghai was just a minor city until the concessions to the British and French made it a major trading port. It's actually on a giant mud flat. And he just kind of talked about the history of the concessions there and how they all developed. He also found this very old townhouse whose owner I'm not going to particularly remember, but was very much known for, was very much known as sort of this idyllic kind of garden house in the madness that was China in the colonial times, as well as it is kind of the madness of China, particularly in Shanghai of the modern times. Not necessarily political madness, but just sort of the workaday attitude of Shanghai and just how kind of intense it can be. He also talked about the Oriental Pearl Tower, which was the first of the towers in the Pudong district to go up. Since then, there have been, this book was written in 95. Since then, there have been a number of other buildings that have gone up in Pudong. But he described the Oriental Pearl Tower as a monstrosity, which it kind of is. It's in a way, it's beautiful, but in a way, it's just kind of... yeah, feels like something like a child would put together with like the spire and all the orbs. I've been there, I've seen it, so it's pretty interesting. I think he talked about the, yeah, like I said, the French concession. He talked about how there really was never a lot of fighting, I don't think, in Shanghai. Though I guess the one time there was when the Japanese took over in 37. And it's not so much that there was military fighting, but that... that it was sort of a prelude to what happened in Nanjing with a lot of the sort of pillaging. There wasn't so much raping at this point, but there was just sort of like military control, like crazy military control by the Japanese as they came in. The next chapter is, let's see, the first reach. That's essentially about, let's see if I can get to it real quick. That is about the city that is kind of like the has the main bridge or the first bridge over the Shang. Oh no, it doesn't have the first bridge, but it's kind of the first. Yeah, I know what it is. It's the first spot where they are like cliffs. And so before Shanghai and before when all that was kind of washed out delta, and they didn't really have the technology to kind of clear the land, to clear the swampland. Let's see if I can get the name right. Oh, no, that's not it either. This town was kind of the major port on the bottom end. Yangju and Xinjiang. And he just kind of talks about some of the city there, how it's kind of not backward, but not really well known. Oh, this is also the point. Okay, he also talks about the thing that really made it was the port going along the Yangtze, but it was also the point where the Yangtze met the Grand Canal, which was, I think, maybe even still to this day, the longest single canal in the whole world. Now, that being said, it's a very skinny, very shallow canal. Really good for junks, but you can't really do any major shipping there nowadays. And so during the Song Dynasty, that's when this town was really at its height as sort of a mercantile. Hello? Sort of a mercantile capital. So, yeah, it was kind of interesting. Let's see what else he says in First Reach. I kind of took some time to read this book, so I'm forgetting like certain aspects of it. Oh, yeah, the Chinese River Dolphin. He talked about that in there. And in case I forget it later on, he mentioned the Chinese alligator, the Chinese River Dolphin, and the Chinese porcupine or something. These have all since become extinct in the Yangtze, which is really sad. But at the time period, they were like the last few animals that were just barely kind of hanging on before they were extinct. You know, the Shanghai or the Yangtze in its lower reaches has become very polluted with modern industrial China just kind of dumping wonton pollutants into its river. I mean, that's the case even in like the United States or countries that have higher standards of pollutants. You can imagine what it's like in China, which really, until very recently, really didn't give two coins about the state of their rivers. Let's see, is there anything else here? Small jetty. Oh yeah, I think this was where, in 1949, I think it was the HMS Amherst, was the last sort of ship that was going along the Yangtze. The Yangtze being more or less patrolled, much like the concessions, by foreign police having foreign rule, not necessarily on its banks, but in terms of policing of the river itself. And obviously this became like a huge stain on the national psyche of the Chinese, in addition to the number of other concessions that happened in the late Manchu period in the 1800s. And so when it finally rolled around in 1949, the communists took over. I'm a little surprised that the nationalists didn't kick them out, though I guess the nationalists were kind of allied with Britain and France in the Great War, the World War II against the Japanese. So maybe they continued to let them have control of the river even after the war. But in 1949, when the communists finally took over, there was this big incident with the HMS Amherst where they got stranded and essentially hit with a bunch of cannonballs from the riverside. Had to kind of like at nighttime repair their ship and then kind of hunker down during the day when the more fire went on. And then eventually, by lowering their flag, by cutting their anchor, rather than trying to raise it up, which would create like a big ruckus and obviously inform the Chinese that they were trying to move on, they left. And actually they did this on this little embankment island in the middle of the Yangtze, around Yangju or whatever it is. Around Yangju. Okay, so that's first reach. City of Victims. Okay, so this is about Nanjing. And the biggest part about this was the various massacres that have gone on there. It's been a city of kind of boom and bust throughout its history, and it certainly had a number of massacres. And it's also been the capital, as I said, or been the capital numerous times. Let's see. But really the most famous incident was the rape of Nanjing. Actually, there was the Nanjing Massacre that happened in, like, I think when the Nationalists, like, first took over. Like, in, I want to say, like 21 or something like that, 1921. Or maybe it's, like, 26. But there was a big massacre going up, and then there was a later massacre after the famous massacre when Mao Zedong took over Nanjing and moved the capital back to Peking, or as we now as Beijing. But the most famous massacre was, I believe, 1937, or maybe it was 39, I don't know, my dates are kind of off, when the Japanese invaded Nanjing. This is very, very famous, and it's become a huge political potato of getting Japan to acknowledge what happened there after the war. There was, I think it was estimated, like, maybe like 60,000 people were killed, and like 250,000 were either became refugees or were missing, or it was just terrible. It was really the worst thing about it was the battle was relatively short, but the Japanese general in charge, whose name I believe begins with an I, maybe like Ishii or something like that, he just let the soldiers go wanton. So really most of the deaths were civilians, where they used civilians as bayonet practice, as targeting practice. They set them on fire. There were huge amounts of rapes of the women, where they would rape them and then immediately kill them. I mean, that's just awful. But one of the things that was a little less known was the experimental camps that went on the Chinese populace by the Japanese. It has like a name, and it's like something, 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 and then it's like a couple of letters. And essentially the Japanese have never acknowledged this. I don't see exactly what it's called, but kind of the thing that stuck in my head is they called Japanese logs or wood. Like that was they didn't call it Japanese. The Japanese called the Chinese logs or wood in these camps. And so it sort of dehumanized them and then allowed the Japanese to have all sorts of crazy experiments on them, from, you know, anthrax to, I don't know, just like intentionally having snake bites, or like, you know, like cutting vital organs out and seeing how they responded. It was really on the scale of what happened in Daku. I think that was where it was. And I can't remember his name either, but maybe Mengele, the guy that killed all the, or experimented on all the Jews in Nazi Germany during World War II. I mean, it was that equivalent. But it's less known in the West, I think partially because it was very strongly covered up. Like the Japanese essentially murdered everyone that was involved in this program and then burned all the camps down. And two, there just wasn't a good record on it after the Nationalists took over, because the Nationalists were in a state of disarray themselves. They couldn't maybe like create the same records that like Americans or even Soviets or British could in the West. So that's Nanjing. He talks about some other things in Nanjing, but I don't know, capital, something. Japanese in disbelief. Okay, so the next he goes to the city of the rising waters, and really he talks here a lot about kind of the flooding and the catastrophic effects of the floods. This, once he gets to Yin Kuang and Zhuang Jiang and Wuhu, that's the name of it, Wuhu, W-U-H-U. He's really in the rice heartland of the Yangtze. This isn't near the coast anymore. It's in the heartland. And so part of the heartland of all this silt and water that comes down is able to produce a huge amount of rice. But it's also able to produce a huge amount of flooding. And that is a big, big problem here. Now, the one good thing is that there are numerous lakes around this region that he was, some of them being man-made, which is pretty incredible. Essentially, the Chinese kind of, this is all very flat land, and they recognize kind of areas that have very minor depressions. And so they would dig canals into these minor depressions to allow some of the excess flow in the wet season of the Yangtze to flood into these lakes and have some margin of control. That being said, it really didn't prevent the greatest amount of flooding. There's huge amounts that were killed, I think in, I don't know the year, but there was one sometime in the 20th century where there was a huge amount of flooding that went on. He says, Yangtze to be an uncontrollable monster. So, crushed, torn, curled. This is in Junjuang and Guiluan. It's in the same lakes district. Matter of fact, it's under Puying Hu. I like how you're going like this with the book, but whatever. I have to listen to my rambling. So this area was really known for its tea prior to the British. But the British essentially fought the Opium Wars and started getting these concessions for the tea, but ultimately pulled the rug out from under the Chinese when they realized that tea could grow as well, green tea, and then black tea is essentially fermented green tea. So they could grow the tea just as well in Assam, which essentially undermined the without Chinese control, Assam being in a province of India, which was under direct control rather than just like concessionary control of the British Empire. They fought all these opium wars, essentially kind of gutted a big part of China with the drug epidemic of opium. And then the one commodity that China did have to trade, again, they pulled the rug out and moved it to India. To the point where Guilin is still known for its tea, but like the fields are largely fallow. And when Simon went to the place where they grow the tea, this museum, or not where they grow the tea, but this museum, it was essentially like in this back room with a bunch of sleepy receptionists that really didn't have anything to show for it. And that was really quite sad. Something else about this area, Guling, is it has very good access to the transportation routes, being close to Wuhan, as well as the Yangtze River itself, Wuhan being a big railroad capital. But it has some mountains that are very, rise fairly precipitously. And so it became sort of known as a mountain retreat for various rulers over the age. Chiang Kai-shek built a retreat there, as well as Mao Zedong that made, I think, a famous declaration there. I think it was maybe shortly after he declared the Republic in... No, I think it was maybe he declared, like, the Red Guard there. It had something to do with the military. But it's very famous for having Mao Zedong there. And even though they don't have a proper tea museum, they do have a proper memorial to the proclamation that Mao Zedong, of course being China, being made in that area. Speaking of Mao Zedong, the next chapter is about Wuhan, and kind of one of the lead things in there is swimming, and that is that, you know, most Western leaders outside of maybe like Vladimir Putin, who's off with his shirt or whatever, or maybe George Bush, like cutting brush, don't need to show their physical prowess in order to prove their political acumen. But this was very much a, was very much a thing that happened in China, in particularly in Mao's time. It was, it was very much seen that the peasantry didn't matter. What was important was showing, or they did matter, but kind of the optics of showing the might of the leader would lead the rest of the populace. And so Mao Zedong, I think three different times, swam across the Yangtze River in Wuhan. Wuhan, what else do I need to say about it? I know the last one was the crazy one because it was like 1964, I want to say. China was kind of under a crisis where the Great Leap Forward had kind of like stalled out. And they were just sort of directionless as a country. And Mao had kind of retreated, not made a lot of public appearances. But he came out to swim the Yangtze for the third time. I think the first time is maybe when he declared the Great Leap Forward, or maybe shortly thereafter. But the third time was a crazy time because immediately embarking on the far bank, that's when he thought he was going to revitalize China by making a massive declaration. And that is when he declared the Cultural Revolution was starting. And if you know anything about China, it was just a huge disaster. And this is kind of like a ghoulish starting point to show the greatness of Mao Zedong, the greatness of the nation. The third time he swam with like 300 like middle school type kids across the river, a number who drowned, which obviously wasn't mentioned in the press. But kind of with the youth of the nation, he declared the Cultural Revolution and the insanity that existed for the next, like 10 years or so. Wuhan itself is sort of, again, kind of in the wet belt. It exists on both sides of the river in three different parts, in Wuchang, Hangyuan, and Hangzhou. It's sort of like, even though it's not as cold, matter of fact, it's described as the furnace, one of the four furnaces of China. A lot of people sort of see it as like the Chicago of China. So Chicago in the United States, it's not the capital, but what it is it has a lot of political fervent. So does Wuhan. It's a big industrial city, and so is Wuhan, in terms of the factories there, but also in terms of the transportation up and down the river. I think there's also, Simon mentioned that there's a lot of Hong Kong investment in Wuhan. I believe that he said that that was the case. But in any case, it's just sort of like this gargantuan kind of not very beautiful kind of rumbling city that exists in the middle of the country, and kind of just kind of the smog and soot from above and the water from below just make it kind of this very docklands kind of rough city. He didn't really mention too much beyond that, just saying that it was kind of not so great. It's a big railway city. That's what he's mentioning. We mentioned that there was a huge controversy. That's what it was. There was a huge controversy there because it was the first. I mentioned how it was very political. It was the first, one of the first rebellion spots of the communists. And this specifically being because foreign powers were really the ones building the railroads across China in the early 20th century. But there were rail technicians within China, and so they formed these collectives, I guess you call them Soviets in Russia, that kind of fermented dissent. And they were actually found out about by their leader. But because they had for so long planned and planned and planned, and then all of a sudden had to attack, they were able to overtake the railroads in Wuhan. And it was one of the first major victories, I think, even before the war. I think they were eventually pushed out by the nationalists. But it was kind of seen as, it wasn't like a couple guys took over a building once. Like, they properly took over stuff. It was interesting. There's a lot, the good earth was kind of taken here. Yeah, so. Oh, geez. The washing machine's going on in the background. I apologize. The Great New Wall. The Great New Wall is the Three Gorges Dam. That is in essentially China. I previously mentioned flood control. The Three Gorges is a very hard navigational area. These are all pluses that Simon mentions early on for the Three Gorges Dam. You can see why the Chinese might want to put a dam there. In addition, the Three Gorges Dam is the one spot where the river is kind of tricky between population centers. Now, further upriver, the river becomes innavigable. But in the Three Gorges, the entire province of Sichuan is cut off, or at least not cut off, but like under harder shipping conditions. And there have to be a lot smaller boats in order to get things from Sichuan down past the Three Gorges. Once you get past the Three Gorges and into the Wuhan area, I mean, you can have huge, huge barges because there's no real proper rapids or, the river is huge. It's basically like a boulevard or a freeway of shipping. So that's why they built the Three Gorges. Now, damn, if they put the dam up, then they can have shipping all the way from Shanghai to Chongqing. Chongqing has like 20 million people. It's a huge, huge city with the big boats. It's essentially using locks along the Three Gorges Dam to get above the dam and then use the lake to get back to the place. I think the total height of the dam is maybe like 600 feet, I think. Or maybe 660 feet. But now the downsides. It's going to ruin the beauty of the dam. A lot of the historical stuff that goes on in the dam in terms of shipping is going to be destroyed, though a lot of that honestly has been destroyed by modernization of technology. Specifically what I'm thinking is the porters that you get like 40 of them. And where boats couldn't navigate on their own, they tied these long ropes, and then like 40 or 50 porters would drag the boats up the Yangtze River. Jeez, why can't I remember that? But those have largely gone by the wayside because of ships. Now, the one person he does mention is, I believe, Plant is his name. And Plant was super important to the dam, or not to the dam, but to the history of navigation. It's obviously English, because Simon covers everything in English. And he created like a navigational system, like up and down. And actually, Simon goes and sees his memorial, which is sad. One, because it's chipped out by during the Cultural Revolution of all the information, even though the obelisk still stands. But secondly, because where the Cultural Revolution didn't succeed in completely destroying the monument, in a way, the dam will, because it'll be below the level of where the big lake is once the Three Gorges Dam is put in place. He also meets some families there, and specifically this old man. He says a family of maybe like 10 people that all live in one household. And it's mentioned that the kids, and even to some degree the grown-ups, will be able to adjust to the forced move that the Chinese are putting upon them. But Simon created this visual of this old man smoking the pipe, just looking at the land that he hadn't moved from, he hadn't worked, or that he had worked his entire life, that he was just right there. That was his spot. In his 90s or something like that, he was going to be moved to an apartment in almost an alien environment from where he was. So, there's upsides and there's downsides to the dam. Another downside is that they say there's so much silt in the dam that or in the river, that when the dam kind of comes around, that there's really not going to be, it'll start jamming up the turbines and it'll really kind of mess it all up. I'm sure that whatever has happened, that's actually started. But as I said, this book was written in 95, so maybe the Chinese figured something out, but there is criticism to be had. It's the Three Gorges Dam. Goes into Chong Quen, kind of talks about how it was the revolutionary capital. I really got to start going here. This review is getting long. The revolutionary capital during the war. How it's kind of a grimy city. What I find interesting is actually the river itself is maybe like 50 feet below the city. And so one advantage of the dam is that they're going to raise, and there's like nobody that lives on these steep cliffs that go down to the river itself. I think it's just like the effect of water over time created these sort of like, not super big walls, not like the Three Gorges or even like the Tiger Leaping. But they created these, 50-foot walls that people had to take, like, stairs down to get to the river. But Chong Quen is going to be, like, the very end of the lake. So they raised the Three Gorges Dam so that it would raise to the level of the city in Chong Quen, which will make it really convenient for shipping, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Well, you mentioned Chiang Kai-shek and how the capital was there. Boats, dock, 95. I think this was the chapter they talked about, like, some really old skeleton that was found in the region. Beyond Chong Quen, and specifically a little bit upriver, kind of at the mouth of the Tiger Leaping Gorge, the river essentially becomes innavigable. So at this point, Simon and I should say Lily, who is mentioned often throughout the book, how did I get 32 minutes in and not talk about her? He wanted a travel companion, so he met this woman, Lily, that kind of created some off-color, just was a good sort of, two-person team, good banter back and forth with them throughout the book. So I really should mention a lot more about Lily, but there's so much content in the book that I kind of want to talk about that. Goes into Yunnan, sees the Tiger Leaping Gorge, kind of walks through it. There's a big mining operation that actually the rocks fall over the track where as you walk along the Tiger Leaping Gorge, so people actually die by like falling rocks. You'd think they would have like a better system worked out than that, but they don't. Being the Chinese, I guess. Visits Li Zhang in Yunnan, sees a lot of the ancient people, including the Dai and the there was another group that was like really big too. And then he goes up into the mountains and spends quite a bit of time trying to find the source, goes to Lhasa. I'm kind of running through the last third of this book just because this review is running so long, but his car breaks down multiple times up in the very remote parts of Tibet, being surrounded by what is Chinese civilization for two-thirds of his trip, and then being in the real remote parts of the Yangtze River. What's really interesting is that the Yangtze was not thought of as the proper Yangtze until relatively recently. because there's another branch of the river that is a lot has a lot more flow and navigational ability, but is only 500, I don't know if it's kilos or miles, it's kind of lazy of me, long. Yeah, that being the, I believe the Yalong, let's see, where is it? The Yalong Jinang, I think. Where's Chongqing here? Oh no, not even that. Or maybe it's the Min, maybe it's the Mianjiang. Yeah, that's what it is. Yeah, because that's where Chengdu is. Has a lot bigger flow, but only runs for a short period. Whereas where those two rivers meet, the Yangtze runs on for like 2.5 times that. In all that area, well, there's some population in Yunnan, but beyond Yunnan is completely depopulated. It's like all just a few nomadic herders up in Tibet. So he kind of drives around Tibet some, stays in an army camp up there and at like 1,800 feet, which is crazy, way up high, up in the Tibetan plateau. And then he doesn't reach the source, but he kind of sees very close to the end. There being kind of two sources, the Dam Ku and the Tutu He. And so he doesn't quite reach the source because it's like super cold and he risks kind of exposure and death by doing it. But he's able from the vantage point on the road to see the mountain and the glacier where the river starts. And that's kind of where the book ends. And he just kind of gives a very quick wrap up, and that's the book. So, super long review. River at the Center of the World by A Journey Up the Yangtze and Back in Chinese Time by Simon Winchester. All right, check it out, you guys. It's a good book. Bye.